Today, I am going to explain the stream ciphers and block ciphers. So, what are the stream ciphers and what is about block ciphers? First of all, stream cipher. Stream cipher means whatever the text we want to send, that can be generally that can be represented in the binary digits, bits. So, in the case of the stream cipher, that encrypts the, it encrypts the data bit by bit or one byte at a time. A stream cipher is one that encrypts a digital data stream one bit or one byte at a time. That means it encrypts the text bit by bit. That's why it is called stream cipher. It receives the text and encrypts that text bit by bit. That's why this is called stream cipher. Example for the stream ciphers are the generally they are auto keyed vision area cipher or Wernham cipher. These are the two examples of the stream ciphers. For example, here if you consider the diagram, how this is working, see this, how it is working. Assume this is the, you are sending the plain text PI means first bit to in the P1 means first bit, P2 second bit, P3 third bit, that is the PI. So each and every bit or each and every byte from the plain text is the PI. So you are sending the plain text bits here, and in this way the bit stream generation algorithm, which takes a key value which is useful for the encryption purpose. So the bit stream generation algorithm takes a key value, and that key is subdivided as ki bits. That means k bit one of the first, bit one of the key, bit two of the key, bit three of the key. So here from this side the bits of the keys are coming from this side. These are the bits of the key value, and from this side it receives the bits from the plain text. So these are combined here using exclusive OR operation. So here the plain text bits and the key bits are joined and generates the ciphertext and generates the ciphertext CI. For example, it is the first, it takes the P1 and it receives the K1 key bit K1, then it generates the ciphertext bit C1. Like that, it takes P2 bit, K2 key, and generates the C2 ciphertext, like that. So this is at encryption side. So it encrypts the bit by bit. It encrypts the bit by bit of the plain text. Now, if you see at decryption side, it receives the ciphertext bits, and by using this bit tree generation algorithm, it takes our key and it this generates the bits from the K, that is KI. So here KI bits from key and CI bits from the ciphertext are joined, and after performing some operations, it converts the ciphertext into the plain text PI. So for example, if it receives the C1 bit from the ciphertext, K1 bit from the key, then by combining this C1 and K1, by using those two, we will get the plain text bit P1. So like that, the next cipher, second bit of the cipher text, that is C2. Next key bit from the key, that is K2, both are generating the P2, the second bit of the plain text. So this is the structure of the stream cipher. Next one is the block cipher. Here the block cipher means a block cipher is one in which a block of plain text is treated as a whole. Here in the block cipher, it treats a block of plain text is treated as a whole and used to produce the ciphertext block of equal length. For example, it is not concentrating, it is not receiving the bit by bit. So here it considers some n bit word. It takes some n bit word from the plain text. That can be assumed as a block. So if the plain text is converted into the number of blocks, now this block cipher encrypts the block by block, not bit by bit. It encrypts the plain text block by block and generates the cipher text block by block. So this is the block cipher. Typically, generally, the block size of this cipher is, generally the block size is 64 bit or 128 bit or 256 bit, like that. Generally, the block size of the plain text is 64 bits or 128 bits. That means this encryption algorithm receives from the plain text at a time 64 bits as one block. Then it receives next 64 bits as second block. Like that, it encrypts block by block. So see the structure of this cipher. So here, isn't this is the plain text. So this is the it contains B bits, and from this side it takes the key value. This algorithm receives one block at a time from the plain text, first block of the plain text first, then using this key value, it encrypts and generates the cipher text of the same size block. Suppose if you assume the block size is 64 bits, each and every block size is 64 bits, then first the encryption algorithm receives first 64 blocks as first 64 bits as the first block, and using this key value, it encrypts that one and generates the first block of the cipher text with the 64 bits size, equal size. So then the encryption algorithm receives the second block, and using the same key, it generates the second block of the cipher text. So it encrypts the plain text block by block. What is here, another cipher is there, that is called modern block cipher. Previously we have seen stream cipher, then block cipher. Now this is the modern block cipher. So if you observe the modern block cipher, this is the symmetric key modern block cipher. It encrypts an n bit block of plain text or decrypts n bit block of cipher text. The encryption or decryption algorithm uses the k bit key here. It is not the single key, it uses k bit key. But in the previous case, normal block cipher uses a key. It directly uses a key for encrypting every block into cipher text block. So it uses the same key for all the blocks. But in the case of modern block cipher, the encryption and decryption algorithms uses a k-bit key. So this encryption algorithm receives the n bit size blocks one by one, and using the k bit key it encrypts and generates the n bit cipher text, n bit block cipher text as the output. So it generates it uses the k bit block. This is the symmetric key modern block cipher that encrypts n bit block plain text or decrypts an n bit block of cipher text. Here encryption and decryption algorithms are using the k bit key. That means for every block it uses some k bit key. If you see this structure, the encryption algorithm, this is some algorithm, it receives the n bit block from the plain text, n bit size block from the plain text, and uses some k bit key that encrypts and generates the n bit cipher text. At decryption side, this decryption algorithm receives n bit block cipher text, and using this k bit key it decrypts and converts into the n bit block plain text. So this is the modern block cipher. So you have to remember, modern block cipher uses k bit key. Suppose if the message has fewer than n bits, in this situation you have to padding must be added to make it an n bit block. So this is nothing but, for example, if your bit size is n bit word size is n word size is 64 bit size, assume the block size is 64 bit size, this is the n value is 64 bit size. So if the block size is 64 bits and you have the only, assume you have only 52 bits in the plain text, only 52 bits in plain text, just assume like that. So even this size is less than the block size 64 bits, at that time additionally it adds some 12 bits, some padding bits to our plain text. So then it converts into the, it totally its length is 64 bit and assumed as a one block, and it assumed as one block. So if your plain text has fewer than the n bits, some padding must be added make it an n bit block. For example, if the plain text contains 52 bits only and the actual block size is 64 bits, that's why you should add some 12 bits padding, some 12 padding bits to your plain text to make it a block, then it takes one block for the decryption. This is one case. What is that one? If the plain text has fewer than n bits, that means the size of the plain text is less than the block size, then some padding bits must be added. Next case is if the message has more than n bits, then it should be divided. The entire message is divided into n bit blocks. And the appropriate padding must be added. Here also the appropriate padding must be added to the last block if necessary. Generally the bits, what are the block sizes? Generally we are using 64 bit size or 128 bit size, or these are the block sizes. For example, so here the second case, if you observe the second case, suppose if you have the plain text, if we have the plain text with only 120 bits, the size of the plain text is only 120 bits, only 120 bits. Assume like that. Now, if you wanted to convert this 120 bits plain text into blocks, so you should divide this into, you should divide that 120 by 64, that is the block size. Then this is divided as first 164 ones, that is 64. What are the remaining bits? What are the remaining bits? These are the 50. What are the remaining bits after what is remainder? So 120 minus 64, that is 36, and that is 56 bits are remaining bits are 56. So it's already one block, the 120 bits size plain text is divided into one block, that is confirmed, and we have extra 56 bits. So it is less than 64 bit size. That's why you have to add some 8 bits, padding bits, to the second block. So its size becomes 64 bits. So how many bits we have added here? 8 bits. For make the second block, you have to add 8 bits. That is the second case. Example. For example, how many, here we have one problem. How many padding bits must be added to a message of 100 characters if 8-bit ASCII is used for encoding and block cipher accepts blocks of 64 bits? So here the block size is 64 bits. What is the block size is? Here the block size given as 64 bits. And what is our plain text or message? The message contains 100 characters. And actually 100 characters means each character is 8 bits size. Each character contains 8 bits, 8 binary. Each character is represented in ASCII form. ASCII format is 8 bits. That's why 100 characters into 8 is equal to 800. So the message, our message contains 800 bits because it has 100 characters into 8 is equal to 800 bits. Now convert or divide this 800 bits plain text into number of blocks. For that you have to divide this 800 bits plain text by 64 block size. Then you have 800 by 64 means so this is 12 blocks, 12 into 64 means 12 blocks plus 12 blocks plus 32 bits, plus 32 bits are there. So our 800 bits plain text is divided into 12 blocks plus 32 bits. So at the last block, there is 32 bits deficiency. That's why you have to add 32 more bits to the last block to become it as 64 bit size. So after adding 32 bits to our 32 padding bits to our plain text, now it has 13 blocks. It is divided into 13 blocks. So this is calculated like this. For example, assume this is the size of the message. This is the size of the padding bits. So actually size of the message plus size of the padding bits, totally the sum is congruent to zero after modulo divide with 64. So by using this formula, the padding, total number of padding bits is equal to this, come to this side, minus m mod 64. That's why padding bits equal to minus 800 mod 64. This is equal to 32 bits size. So we have added 32 bits. This is one way of calculating the padding bits, or otherwise this is another way. This is very, very important. Sometimes this type of problems will be given. Now, generally, the modern block ciphers can be designed to act as substitution cipher or transposition cipher. They are using the modern block ciphers can be designed to act as a substitute cipher or a transposition cipher. Generally, to be resistant to exhaustive search attack, to be resistant to exhaustive search attack, otherwise brute force attack. This is nothing but brute force attack. So to be resistant to this brute force attacks, a modern block cipher needs to be designed as a substitute cipher. A modern block cipher need to be designed as a substitute cipher instead of transposition cipher. So the modern block ciphers can be designed by using substitution ciphers to avoid exhaustive search attack or brute force attack. Now, what are the components of the modern block ciphers? Generally, how the modern block ciphers are designed? Modern block ciphers normally are keyed substitution ciphers in which the key value allows only partial mappings from the possible inputs to possible outputs. Generally, the modern block ciphers, these are using some P boxes or S boxes or some other components. Now, what is the P box or what is about S box? So here P box is called as the permutation block, which is permutation block. That means what we have understood in transposition cipher. What we have done in the transposition cipher, we have permutated the bit positions. Just we reorder the bit positions. That is the transposition cipher. That is also called as the permutation. So here we are using some permutation box. Actually, this is also called as a D box, means diffusion box. So the permutation box, P box, also called as a D box. Now the modern block cipher uses the P box or permutation box, which parallels the traditional transposition cipher for characters. It transposes the bits. So what is the use of the permutation box? It transposes the bits. That means suppose if our plain text has 800 bits. Now our plain text is divided into some 64 size blocks, and the bits in the 64 bit block are reordered or some change mixed. Their positions are changed. That is called permuted. So for making the confusion to the attackers. So just we have reordered the bits in the plain text. That is called permutation. That can be done by using the permutation box. So this is the use of the permutation box. It parallels the traditional cipher, the transposition cipher for characters. It transposes the bits. That is the P box. It is also called as D box. What is the diffusion box? Diffusion is nothing but just to make the confusion. if you hide the relation between the plain text characters and the ciphertext characters, if you hide that relation, then that is called diffusion. So that's why it is also called as the D box. Mainly it is called P box or permutation box. This is one of the component of motor block cipher. Now generally P boxes are three types. Straight P box is one type of P box. Then compression P box, this is another one. Then expansion P box. So one is straight P box. Another is compression P box. Third one is expansion P box. Now see the straight, why it is called straight P box. Suppose if it is the P box and assume it has 5 bits as the input. So assume this is the P box, for that the 5 bits are sent as the inputs. It receives the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bits as input. But at the output side, here the second bit of the input becomes as first bit, and this fifth bit is come as second bit, and fourth bit is come as the third bit, then this first bit as fourth bit. So all bit positions are changed. That means this is P box changes all the bit positions of the input. So here why it is called straight P box? Here it takes five inputs and it gives 5 outputs, the same five bits it gives as the output. But in this output the bit position of the input is changed at the output. That is called permutation. So state box means it takes n bits as the input and it returns n bits as the output. This n bits as the input and n bits as the output. So this is the straight P box. Now come to the compression P box. Compression P box means it takes some n number of bits as the input, but it gives its less than n number of bits as the output. Example, so it takes some 5 bits as input, but it gives only 3 bits as the output. The input is 5 bits, but the output is only 3 bits. That means the input is compressed. For example, in this example, it takes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 as the input bits, but in the output of this P box is only 1, 2, 3. That means first bit is returned and third bit is returned as second bit and fifth bit is returned as third bit. Here the second bit of the input, fourth bit of the input are blocked. They are blocked, but just it returns 1 bit, 3rd bit, 5th bit as 1, 2, 3 bits as the output. So it takes 5 bits, but returns only 3 bits as the output. So it compresses the input. So it is called compression P box. So next one is the expansion P box. Expansion P box means it takes some n bits as the input, but it gives its more than n bits as the output. For example, here it takes 3 bits as the input. But it returns 5 bits as output. It takes 3 inputs, but gives 5 bits as the output. That's why it is called expansion. So how we assumed this one? This is very simple. For example, here the first bit of the input is returned as at two positions in the output. So the first bit is returned as first position, the same bit is returned as fourth bit position. Now third bit also two times returned in the output. So some of the bits are repeated, some of the input bits will be repeated at output. That's why we will get more number of output bits than the input bits. That's why this is called expansion. This is called the expansion P-box. Now assume we have the 3x3 straight P-box. 3x3 straight P-box. Then these are the different input and output combination. For example, here see 1 to 1, same 1 to 2, same they are returned as it is. But here this one position came as two position, the second bit is at the first position. Otherwise these are different alternatives, these are different permutations for the 3x3 P box. Now this is one of the example of the permutation table. Assume we have the some permutation box P box with 64x64. That means it takes 64 bits as input and 64 bits as output. So it has the 64 bits. The first 58 shows that at the output, suppose if it is the P box, it receives the input from 1 bit to 64 bits, otherwise 0 bit to 1 bit to 64 bits, it received as input. From that input to 1 to 64 bits, the 58th bit as the 58th bit of the input goes as to first position in the output. So this 58 in this table indicates the 58th bit of the input is returned at first position in the output of the P box. Then this 50 indicates the 50th bit of the input will be returned at second position in the second position at the output. So this 42, since it is at third position, the 42nd bit of the input will be displayed as third bit in the output. 34 will be displayed at fourth bit output. This will be displayed as fifth bit output. So like that, so each and every value according to their position, this value indicates the position indicates here the position indicates there the in the output position, the value indicates this input value goes to that position like that. Now example, we have one problem. Suppose if we wanted to construct 8-bit input P box and 8 input and 8 bits as output permutation table. Now if it is the straight P box, assume in that P box that moves two middle bits, fourth bit and fifth bits in the input word to the two ends. That means the first position and the eighth bit position. So here fourth bit and fifth bit from the input, they go as the first position and eighth position, that means two ends in the output. The remaining bits are unchanged. That means then what is the sequence of the bits in the output of the P box? So at first position we have the fourth bit, at the end we have this fifth bit, at the end we have this fifth bit, then remaining bits are unchanged. So this is the sequence of the P box at outside output. Now, this is the how the compression P box works. Actually, assume it is the 32 bit, it takes 32 bits as the input, but gives only 24 bits as the output. Takes 32 bits, but gives 24 bits. So if you observe these values, some of the bits are blocked. For example, there is no 7th value, there is no 8th value, 9th value, 15th. So these values are blocked. These values are blocked from the input. So that's why we have only 24 bits. Now, if you observe this 24 input and 16 output permutation box, so we have only 12 bits as input, but output has 16 bits. So how we achieve this one? Some of the bits will be repeated. For example, observe this one, same one will be repeated here. That means one is positioned at two places in the output. Similarly, three, observe there are two threes, nines, two nines will be there, 12s also two places there. So this is the permutation box, that is the expansion box. Now see the invertibility, a straight P box, whether what is the meaning of the invertibility? Generally, invertibility means we use the straight P box in encryption cipher and it's inverse. It's inverse at decryption side. So whatever the P box you are using at the encryption side, its inverse should be used at the decryption side. That type of thing is called invertibility. So a straight P box is invertible. A straight P box is invertible, but compression P box and expansion P boxes are not invertible. They are not invertible. So if you see, this is the straight P box. Assume the original table contains 634521 bits. Bit sequence. This is the sequence of the bits. Now, how we get its invertible table? Assume this is the output of the P box. How to get its invertible table? Now, same thing, you have to add, you have to take same values and add some indexes 1, 2, 3, 4 to the given values. These are values are given, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 are indexes. Then in this swap indexes and these values, they just swap indexes and values. That means this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 are, they come to in this box, these values are come to as indexes. Now sort these based on this index. So first 1 6 is here because it is 1, then 2 5. So based on these indexes, sort these values, then we will get this one. So finally, this is the 6 5 2 3 4 1 is the invertible table. That's why straight P box is the invertible. But if you check the compression P box, we cannot invert. For example, see this one, it takes, assume this compression box takes 3 inputs, 1 2 3, but it gives only 2 bits as the output. Now if you try to inverse this one, 1 2 bits as the input, we cannot convert these 2 bits as the 3 bits. So it is not invertible. Similarly, the expansion box also, it is not invertible. Now, S box, it is the substitution box. It can be thought of as a small substitution cipher. Generally, S box is M into N size substitution unit, where M and N are not necessarily the same. Generally, it can be the linear S box or non-linear S box. If the inputs are X1, X2, X3, assume these are the inputs and outputs are the Y1, Y2, Y3. So suppose S box means it takes some input bits and it gives some output box. Substitution means it will substitute some of the values in the place of the input. Some input values will be changed. That is the substitution box. So here, assume x1, x2, x3 are the inputs, y1, y2 are the outputs. Some y1 is equal, assume this y1 is equal to some f1 function, x1, x2, x3 parameters, y2 is equal to f2 function values. So the above relation can be expressed as y1 is equal to some a11 x1 plus a12 x2 like this. y2 is equal to a21 x1, a22 x2 like this. So this is the linear S-box. Now, if sometimes we will have non-linear S-boxes. Suppose sometimes we need to multiply the inputs for getting the output. For example, see this one. In S-box with 3 inputs and 2 outputs, assume we have y1 is equal to x1, exclusive or x2, x3. y2 is equal to x1. So you can convert this one in this matrix form. This is the nonlinear thing. Now, how it is S-box is substituting the values? Generally, assume this is the S-box with the 3 bits input, but 2 bits as the output. 3 bits input, 2 bits as the output. If the input is 3 bits, assume the leftmost to be in among the 3 bits input, leftmost bits placed here, either 0 or 1, the rightmost 2 bits will be placed here. Suppose if the input has 3 bits, for example 110, so or here these are, this can be either 0 or 1. So from this input, leftmost bit is placed here, remaining 2 bits are placed as the columns. Then the inner thing are the values of these values. For example, what is the value for 010? 010 means this is the 0, this is the 10. So the value substituted for 010 is 01. Similarly, what is the value for 111? The value for 1, this 1, 2, this 11 is 01. Like this, these are the substitute values. So it has the 3 inputs and 2 outputs. Similarly, the S-box can be invertible or non-invertible. Suppose if it is invertible, it should contain three inputs and 3 outputs, same number of inputs and same number of outputs. For example, if it is the 3 bits input, 01, these are the 001. Output, the substituted value is also 3 bits. Now, suppose this 101, what is the value? 010. 101 value is 010. If you observe here, for 010, here 010, what is its value? 101. So here for 101 is value is 010. Here for 010 value is 101. So it is invertible. Another component here is we can use the exclusive or component. So it takes x as the input, using some key, it gives the some y output. Product ciphers. Product cipher means generally it is the combination of substitutions, permutations, some and other components. The combination of these type of operations is called the product cipher. Generally, in the case of the substitution cipher, what we have done, we substituted some of the characters in place of some other characters. So one character is substituted with some other characters for make the attacker confusion. In the permutation means we reorder the characters. So the combination of substitutions, permutations is called the product cipher. If you use both the things, that is called product cipher. So introduced the concept of a product cipher. A product cipher is a complex cipher combining substitutions, permutations, and other components. So it is the combination of the S boxes and P boxes transformations. It is the product cipher. There are two classes of product ciphers generally. One type of product cipher is called the facial cipher. Example, DES, the Data Encryption Standard Algorithm. This is one of the standard algorithm. So another is the non-facial cipher. There are two classes of product ciphers. Facial ciphers is one class. Its example is DES algorithm. Another is the non-facial cipher. Example, AES algorithm. That means Advanced Encryption Standard. Now, what is the, we have one word that is called diffusion. Diffusion means the idea of diffusion is to hide the relationship between the ciphertext and the plain text. Suppose if you hide the relation between the plain text and the ciphertext, if you hide that relation, that is called diffusion. So diffusion means if you hide that relation, between the ciphertext and the plain text, the attacker, it is difficult to the attacker to analyze our ciphertext. That is called diffusion. Diffusion means hiding the relation between the ciphertext and the plain text is called diffusion. Confusion means the idea of the confusion is hide the relation between the ciphertext and the key value. If you hide the relation between ciphertext and key value, that relation is hided, then it is confused to the attacker for decrypting of ciphertext. So if there is no relation between the ciphertext and the key value, then it is impossible to the attacker to access our ciphertext. So confusion means confusion hides the relation between the ciphertext and the key. So to make the diffusions and the confusions and diffusion, and by making the diffusions and confusions, so we can secure our data in the transmissions. One more thing is rounds. Diffusion and confusion can be achieved using iterative product ciphers, where each iteration is a combination of S box and P box and other components. Here, the diffusion and confusions can be done. So these transpositions or substitutions can be done at different rounds, at different levels. That's why we make our ciphertext is more secure. So if you try to transposition or substitutions at different rounds, at different levels, that gives the more security to our ciphertext. So example, it is the example. So this cipher has the two rounds in the middle. So at the round one, it assume it takes 8-bit plain text. So 8-bit plain text by using some key mixer, then these 8 bits are sent to 4 S boxes. S box 1, it takes 2 bits. S box 2 receives 2 bits. X box 3 receives 3 bits. 2 bits, and last 2 bits are received by the S box 4. Then these inputs, this S box outputs are permuted. This is entered to as 6th bit. This second one is written as 1. This one becomes some here. This come to here. So these values are permuted here. So here S box is using for substitution, and here P box is using for permutation. Then it is in first round. What we have done in the first round? We have done some substitutions, some permutations. Then we will get some 8-bit middle text. These 8-bit middle text also using some key. Again, these characters are substituted by substitute box, and the positions are permuted by using P box. And finally, we get the 8-bit ciphertext. So here we have used two rounds. So rounds means we are adding, just we make the ciphertext more confusing. So at each and every level, at each and every round, we make the ciphertext so more confusing to the attacker. So this is about routes. So here we diffusions confusion by making diffusion confusion and more using more rounds. So we have add more security to our text. Now, what is the Feistel cipher? Feistel cipher structure. So, Feistel cipher text means, if you observe the Feistel cipher, it is not a specific scheme of block cipher. It is design model from which many different block ciphers are divided. Okay, DES, data encryption standard algorithm, is the example to the Feistel cipher. Now, a cryptographic system based on Feistel cipher structure. Uses the same algorithm for both encryption and decryption. So here, for the encryption side and decryption side, it uses the same algorithm. So the main procedure using in the Feistel cipher is, here the input block, whatever the input is as given, the input block is divided into two halves. The first half is the one block. If it takes the input block one block, that is divided in two halves. The first half is called as the L, that's the left side. The right hand side block is called R, In each round, the right half of the block goes through unchanged, but the left side half is the left part of the block is added with some right block with some key that is added, and it is some mixed with the left side half is mixed with some right side with some functionality data, then that becomes here that becomes as the again that becomes as the right side half. The first right side half is becomes as the left side half in the next round. So what we have done here, so in each round the right half of the block goes through unchanged, but the left half L goes through an operation. The left half goes through an operation that depends on the R and the encryption key. So here, before performing the operation on the left half, before that, by using some function, by using some exclusive OR operation, we have taken the left part of the left half of the block and key. By using some key value, by using some function, we exclusive OR that data. Then that we exclusive OR that combination, the combined data with the left half. Finally, the modified left half will be moved as the left, the right half for the next round. The previous right half is moved as the input for the as the left half for the next round. So this is the Feistel cipher structure. So if you observe this one, assume we have the 64-bit block as the input. There two halves are there. Left side block. This is the left block. This is the right block. So left block data is exclusive OR with some right block, right part of the block and K1 value. Using this function, this right half and using this function, it mixes that right half with the key one. This is exclusive OR with the left hand, left half. So left half means, for example, 32 bits. Right side is also 32 bits. So this left side 32 bits is exclusive OR with some data. What is the data? This some function data. This function performs some operation on right half of the data of the block with some first key value. So it takes right half of the block and first key value, performs some function operation, and we will get some data here that is exclusive or with the left half. Then after the exclusive or the left part, it is moved as the right half for the next round, second round, and this previous right half is moved as left part. The same operation will be done. The now second round takes the left part, left half and right half. Same process will be done on in the next round by, but using the some another key K2. Like that, we are using n number of rounds in the Pastel cipher. So this is the procedure. See here, input plain text, left part to left half, right half, exclusive after perform the exclusive operations. These are right side is become as L1. This one becomes as the right one. This is the next round up to n. The reverse process at the decryption side also done in reverse side. Now, block cipher design principles. What are the design principles of the block cipher? Suppose block size. So if the block size is larger, means greater security. If the block size, as per the previous example, what is our block size? 64 bits. If the block size is 128 or 256, then it is more secure. It is greater security, but reduced the encryption decryption speed for the given algorithm. If the block size is more, then encryption decryption algorithms are working slowly. So the greater security is achieved by greater diffusion. Now key size. If the key size is larger, means greater security, but may decrease encryption decryption speed. So if the key size is more, actually it is very difficult for the attacker for accessing the ciphertext. But if the key size is more, encryption decryption algorithms are slower. And the number of rounds. The essence of the Pastel cipher is that a single round offers inadequate security. Generally, every round offers some inadequate security, but the multiple rounds offers increasing more security. Generally, one round at each and every round, it adds some security. For multiple rounds offer the increasing security. Generally, a typical size is 16 rounds. Generally, for every algorithm, generally typical rounds are, total number of rounds are maximum 16 rounds. Sub-key generation algorithm means we are using some algorithm which is useful for generating the key values. And the round function, here we are using some round function also. It performs some operation on the data. And also diffusion and confusions are useful to make the ciphertext more confusing to the attacker.